Hello, chess fans. I hope you had a good week and welcome back to my Soviet chess lessons. Let's improve our chess by looking at games of strong grandmasters from Russia and the former Soviet Union. Here we have a game between the strong grandmaster Vladimir Epishin against the famous grandmaster Lev Polugajevsky, and here is White to move. Epishin here set the goal, let's create a passed pawn in this middle game. He played d5. And it turns out that because of a tactical trick, black can't win a pawn like this. E takes d5, knight takes bishop takes back, and bishop takes d5, takes, and the trick is, can you see it? Rook e8, this prevents black from winning the pawn, because if takes, if kings go up, then takes, and the rook a8 is hanging, with a winning position for white, of course, with an extra rook. That's why after d5, he didn't take on d5, he took on e4, and here also tactics. The passed pawn is created, and this again cannot be taken because this bishop on e7 would hang. Let's see. Bishop takes back, and after some exchanges also of the queens, bishop hangs, and we are a clean bishop up here. That's why after c takes d5, black blockaded this pawn, but we all know the queen is not the best blockading piece. We could even threaten the queen here with this nice move, bishop e5. This cannot be taken because of the discovered check, and we would win the queen. This is a motif, and also after queen d6, the computer found a very interesting tactical solution here. You can already take on g7. I give here an example variation. King takes back, queen check with tempo, comes into h5, threatens checkmate here. There's not so many defensive moves here. Let's try h6, and after queen f7 we see checkmate is unavoidable here on h7. But this is a computer line. Bishop takes g7 looks interesting. In the game, Epishin played queen c2, building a battery with this bishop, and threatens h7 and connecting the rooks and developing the queen. Nice move. And now bishop f6. Takes. And now, if white would take h7, he would lose d5, that's why he protects his valuable passed pawn. Black protects his bishop and goes out of the line of the white bishop, out of the diagonal. And now d6, because this pawn is more important than this pawn on h7. And also d6 prevents black from playing rook d6 and building a blockade. This is not what white wants. He wants to push his pawn forward. g6, preventing this bishop takes h7. d7, the pawn marches forward one square before queening, and a lot of stress for the black pieces here. Okay, bishop c6 threatens it, takes, and now rook E7 goes to the 7th rank and also creates some danger for the king already. And of course, defense D7 pawn. King goes to F8 and threatens the rook. And the queen goes to E2, defends the rook. And this is the aim for the queen, the strong square E5 centralizing. But black sees it and plays queen F6 and again threatens the rook. Now the rook goes back and some regrouping here. And the queen is pushed back. Nice position for white, but is it enough? No, we have to create a second weakness, and this weakness will be the king himself. H4. This is the move. We can push this pawn maybe to a black square, and these squares are weakened, or we can soften up the king. This is a good move, H4, creating a second front or weakness. And now if he plays H5, we still can break up the king after queen E7 and for instance B5 and G4, and if he takes H5 and so on, G4 is here the idea. Okay, but he didn't play H5, he played B5. Maybe he wants to create his own passed pawn. Or he wants to simply make room for the B-rook, let's see. H5, consequent move, rook B6. Okay. This rook threatens the d6 rook, but now we have an interesting check here. If he takes, we take back and have a new queen. That's why the king goes up, and we give another check. And if he goes back to g8, we can play h6. This is winning. That's why he goes to f8. We give another check and push the king out. Then we place the queen on f6 and complete the king hunt with the cutting move rook e1. This threatens queen h8. Can you see it? The checkmate. And this is already a big problem. After rook e1, Polugayevsky gave up the game because he saw all these variations, for instance. As mentioned, if he takes this hanging rook, then we have a checkmate. And if he goes to g8, maybe to avoid this checkmate on h8, we have another trouble for the king. For instance, h6 is winning on the spot, or even more forceful, this rook e8. Takes, and we have again a checkmate in two. Okay, but he saw this and resigns the game. After rook e1, a very strong played game by Epichin against a world famous grandmasters and world championship candidate, Lev Polugayevsky. A nice game with a strong passed pawn in the middle game. Interesting play with the heavy pieces and the creating of a second front here. The connection between the passed pawn, which wandered till the 7th rank, and the kingside attack here. This connection was very interesting, and I hope you found this game very nice as I did. And we all learned from this Soviet chess game here. Okay, guys, thanks for watching. And if you want, we see us in the next videos. Until then, bye bye.